End of chapter 31. Chapter 32. Miss Cornelia discusses the affair.
"And do you mean to tell me, Anne, dearie, that Dick Moore has turned out not to be Dick Moore at all, but somebody else? Is that what you phoned up to me today?"
"Yes, Miss Cornelia. It's very amazing, isn't it?"
It's just like a man," said Miss Cornelia helplessly.
She took off her hat with trembling fingers. For once in her life, Miss Cornelia was undeniably staggered.
"I can't seem to sense it, Anne," she said. "I've heard you say it, and I believe you, but I can't take it in. Dick Moore is dead, has been dead all these years, and Leslie is free."
"Yes, the truth has made her free. Gilbert was right when he said that verse was the grandest in the Bible."
"Tell me everything, Anne, dearie. Since I got your phone, I've been in a regular muddle, believe me. Cornelia Bryant was never so kerflummoxed before."
"There isn't a very great deal to tell. Leslie's letter was short. She didn't go into particulars. This man, George Moore, has recovered his memory and knows who he is. He says Dick took yellow fever in Cuba, and the four sisters had to sail without him. George stayed behind to nurse him, but he died very shortly afterwards. George did not write Leslie because he intended to come right home and tell her himself."
"And why didn't he?"
"I suppose his accident must have intervened. Gilbert says it is quite likely that George Moore remembers nothing of his accident or what led to it, and may never remember it. It probably happened very soon after Dick's death. We may find out more particulars when Leslie writes again."
"Does she say what she is going to do, when she is coming home?"
"She says she will stay with George Moore until he can leave the hospital. She has written to his people in Nova Scotia. It seems that George's only near relative is a married sister much older than himself. She was living when George sailed on the Four Sisters, but of course we do not know what may have happened since."
"Did you ever see George Moore, Miss Cornelia?"
"I did. It is all coming back to me. He was here visiting his Uncle Abner 18 years ago, when he and Dick would be about 17. They were double cousins, you see. Their fathers were brothers and their mothers were twin sisters, and they did look a terrible lot alike. Of course," added Miss Cornelia scornfully, "it wasn't one of those freak resemblances you read of in novels, where two people are so much alike they can fill each other's places, and their nearest and dearest can't tell between them. In those days you could tell easy enough which was George and which was Dick, if you saw them together and near at hand. Apart, or some distance away, it wasn't so easy. They played lots of tricks on people and thought it great fun, the two scamps. George Moore was a little taller and a good deal fatter than Dick, though neither of them was what you would call fat. They were both of the lean kind. Dick had higher color than George, and his hair was a shade lighter, but their features were just alike, and they both had that queer freak of eyes, one blue and one hazel. They weren't much alike in any other way, though. George was a real nice fellow, though he was a scallywag for mischief, and some said he had a liking for a glass even then. But everybody liked him better than Dick. He spent about a month here. Leslie never saw him. She was only about 8 or 9 then, and I remember now that she spent that whole winter over harbor with her grandmother West. Captain Jim was away, too. That was the winter he was wrecked on the Magdalens. I don't suppose either he or Leslie had ever heard about the Nova Scotia cousin looking so much like Dick. Nobody ever thought of him when Captain Jim brought Dick—George, I should say—home. Of course, we all thought Dick had changed considerable. He'd got so lumpish and fat. But we put that down to what had happened to him, and no doubt that was the reason, for, as I've said, George wasn't fat to begin with, either. And there was no other way we could have guessed, for the man's senses were clean gone. I can't see that it is any wonder we were all deceived. But it is a staggering thing. And Leslie has sacrificed the best years of her life to nursing a man who hadn't any claim on her. Oh, drat the men! No matter what they do, it's the wrong thing, and no matter who they are, it's somebody they shouldn't be. They do exasperate me."
"Gilbert and Captain Jim are men, and it is through them that the truth has been discovered at last," said Anne.
"Well, I admit that," conceded Miss Cornelia reluctantly. "I'm sorry I raked the doctor off so. It's the first time in my life I've ever felt ashamed of anything I said to a man. I don't know as I shall tell him so, though. He'll just have to take it for granted."
"Well, Anne, dearie, it's a mercy the Lord doesn't answer all our prayers. I've been praying hard right along that the operation wouldn't cure Dick. Of course, I didn't put it just quite so plain, but that was what was in the back of my mind, and I have no doubt the Lord knew it.